campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.
Kristina Shelton of Green Bay is a Democratic candidate in the 90th Assembly District. The primary is August 11th. Kristina, welcome to WisconsinEye.
Thanks for having me today.
Well, I interviewed the incumbent, Stosh Grzynski, yesterday and discussed this incident late last year when there was an investigation that found he had verbally harassed a staffer. We talked about it. So, so it's not like I'm asking you something I haven't asked him. My question: have Democrats in the 90th Assembly District lost confidence in the incumbent?
Absolutely. How could you not? Our current representative, the incident is he sexually harassed a worker at the Capitol, and because of his behavior, our party leaders asked him to resign, and that's well documented. So. When he failed to do so, they stripped him of his ability to caucus with the Assembly Democrats, and they removed him from his participation in all of his committee assignments. So how could you not lose confidence in someone who can't represent you, especially during this international worldwide health pandemic that we're facing? The issues that people are dealing with every day needs a representative who are in those meetings getting that valuable information. So, you know, we've sort of been at a loss for the past 8 months. Interestingly, too, Steve, I want to mention that I was on a call today with Democratic leaders who have told me that there's going to be some information coming out in the next couple of days, but that they have no plans to allow him back into the caucus or back into his committee assignments. And I know that that's something that he shared with you the other day. So it's unfortunate to me that he's sharing misinformation.
Okay, I do have a list of specific issue questions. I just have one follow-up question.
Sure.
He told me, and this is his terms, I have been sober for 8 months. I've changed. I apologize. Do you want to respond to that?
I mean, look, I think it's great. I think as a human, it's great when people can learn from their mistakes and better themselves. Stosh and I were friends. I supported him in the 2018 election. Of course, I want nothing more for him than to be in a healthy, positive place so that he can be a good father and a good community leader. I think the difference here is that he's an elected official. And regardless of what you think about his behavior, the voters of the 90th do not have representation. And I think there's a saying, if you don't have a seat at the table, you're on the menu. We essentially don't have a seat at the table right now. And again, during the time where we are with as many needs as we have in the 90th, I hope that voters will join me in my campaign and vote for me on August 11th.
Okay, thank you. Time for specific issues. If the governor's right and we don't collect $2 billion in taxes because of the pandemic, do we cut spending or do we raise taxes and fees, Kristina?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I've been thinking about this a lot with my school board work because there's some data that's come out that said, you know, schools are going to be facing a $1.8 million increase in funding, right, to cover the costs of response to COVID-19. So not only school districts, but infrastructure, public health, public services, these different, you know, public safety, these different entities at the state level, their costs are going up, right? Their costs are going up and we had that $2 million budget deficit. I think for me, what's really important is to really ask the question of who is the current economy and the current budget working for? Is it working for working families or is it working for millionaires and billionaires around the state? You know, there was a statistic that came out last week or a few days ago that said of the 8 billionaires in Wisconsin, they made an additional $14.2 billion in collective revenue in the first 3 months of COVID-19. So think about that, right? Think about that, a massive amount of wealth with 8 people who are already billionaires. And so, you know, sure, I'm not a tax expert. There's always more information to learn about taxation, right? It's such an intricate system. But I think to the average person, it's a common sense approach to look at that and say, this isn't right. This isn't American. And there seems to be a disproportionality of who has the amount of wealth and who doesn't. You know, we've asked working families over and over again to make sacrifices, and they've stepped up over and over again to do what's right. And I think when we look at the budget and we look at this deficit, we can recognize that the money's there. We just need to ask the most wealthy to step up and do their part, because these are desperate times.
Okay, new subject. In the wake of the horrible examples of how some police officers treat mm-hmm. those in their custody, the governor put forth a nine-bill package. It would include banning chokeholds, banning no-knock warrants, setting universal training standards statewide. Do you support this package, or do you think it should go further?
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a fantastic first step. I was so excited to see that package come forward with Governor Evers and Lieutenant Governor Barnes. I love the way it was very clear and it outlined and it reflected really what I have been hearing locally in our community as well with our Black and Brown leaders. I've been doing a lot of work over the past 3 to 4 years with Black Lives United, with Women's March Wisconsin. And so that plan really echoed what we've been asking for a number of years. And again, I think they're very common sense approaches that are not only good for Black communities, but they're good for everyone, right? Those are best practices. I think, we've always got to have sort of a long-term vision as well for policing in our communities, so that, we are committed to what safety and security looks like in our communities. So I think that's a great first step. And I think we just have to continue to lean on our leaders from around the state and elevate those voices, because it's also about, LGBTQ folks. It's about queer folks. It's about women. It's about Black, trans women. So we've got to gather all those voices and really say, how can we do a better job to ensure that the policing practices in our state value life over nothing else?
New subject. Where are you on legalizing both medical and recreational marijuana?
Yeah. I love this question, Steve, because when I was thinking about the budget question that you started with, I was looking the other day at some of the statistics coming out of Illinois. They collected over $10 million in revenue on the first month that they legalized recreational marijuana. And it spoke to me, right? Again, another revenue generator. Our laws here at the state level are archaic. They're ineffectual. They're insufficient. And quite frankly, they're racist. If you actually look at who's getting caught up in these marijuana charges and in the prison system, it falls on the backs of our Black and Brown community members. So I absolutely support the legalization of cannabis. Wisconsinites overwhelmingly support medical marijuana. I think we've got to have a vision moving forward for recreational use as well. As a former health education teacher, there's a lot that needs to be done in the planning to make sure that it's done safely, that it's not getting into the hands of children, that adults are using it safely. But we can look to our other progressive neighbors around the country and see that it's being done very well and safely, and it can contribute to a really robust economy and taxes. So.
Okay, new subject. The Constitution says the party in power will draw the next congressional and legislative mm-hmm. district lines. The governor's recommended a people's commission to draw those lines and then forward it to lawmakers. Is the governor right?
Absolutely. We need an independent, nonpartisan people's commission to look at this. It's going to benefit everyone. It's not going to benefit one party or the other. So we've got to be pulling that and then using the 2020 census data to draw those new fair maps. It's unfortunate that we're spending money to defend unconstitutional laws and maps around our state. One of the ways that I've seen gerrymandering turnout here locally in the 90th is, quite frankly, a lot of voter apathy and low voter turnout. I've had voters tell me, it's we're gerrymandered blue. What difference does it make whether it's you or this person? It's sort of neither here nor there. And I think that those are sort of maybe they're not unintended consequences, but those are the long-term consequences on how, this plays out in our role in civic engagement. So I think it's the right call. And again, it's common sense.
As a member of the Green Bay School Board, you've dealt with levy limits and mm-hmm. local governments, caps and levy limits.
Yep.
They're in place because Wisconsin has high property taxes. They can be, you can get around them with passing a referendum. If you're the next representative from the 90th, do you want to get rid of those property tax caps and limits, or you want to keep them?
You know, this is such a complicated issue, right? And it goes back, I was saying this earlier about the rising costs for schools opening up in 2021. We're facing what it's going to be in $1.82 million extra. Here's the way I see it. Madison can either step up and help us cover the rising costs of our COVID-19 response and also the rising costs of just what we face every day here in the 90th. Infrastructure, public health, public safety, education, social services. Our constituents here are facing an increased need, and that increased need comes at a cost. So Madison, I would love for Madison and the legislature to step up and do the right thing to support us. If they're not going to do that, we have to remove the caps to allow the locally elected officials be able to respond in a way that's responsive with their constituents here in the 90th to increase those levy limits as needed. Now, is that an issue if they raise them too high? Sure, but that's why they've got to be working within the community, and voters can hold them accountable by voting them out of office if they don't like those levy cap increases.
Because local governments are so reliant on the property taxes, mm-hmm. is it time to look at alternative revenue sources, things like broadening the 5% state sales tax to now exempt products and services? But what about the idea of letting local governments and not just counties levy a half-cent sales tax?
You know, I struggle with this a little bit, Steve. And again, I'm not a tax expert, and I have a lot to learn here. I think everyone can agree that we all do. What I struggle with the sort of the regressive taxes that we have around like sales and our gas tax is that it's inequitable, right? Those that are poorer and working pay more because it's a percentage of what you're making in your salary. So what I'm paying isn't the same as someone who's making $250,000 right out of my pocket. Right. I think we've got to be thinking more broadly about progressive taxation and ensure that it's equitable and that working families have the resources and the funding that they need to meet their needs, and that our most wealthy citizens around the country are paying their fair share.
The governor was willing to raise a gas tax last year, although it didn't pass. Mm-hmm. We don't have a stable funding source for highways. Would you consider raising the gas tax?
You know, what is it? I think it's that
30.9 cents a gallon, and it hasn't been raised in 10 years.
And he had proposed, I think, for it to jump to 40 cents,
I think he wanted 4 or 5 cents, but memory may fail me.
Yeah, again, I mean, it puts it, we absolutely have to fund our streets. I'm looking into my street and outside of my house, and it's a disaster. And it's terrible on our cars. It's terrible on transportation. So we have to figure out a way to pay for this. But again, raising the tax on gas puts more of the weight on working families. So I'd kind of want to look a little bit more of a progressive tax option. I don't know what that would look like, but that's kind of the take that I use whenever I'm considering the options.
The pandemic means less revenue for all sources, for all types of government, mm-hmm. more demand on health services. We've seen hospitals on the front line nationally and in Wisconsin fighting COVID. If you're in the assembly voting on the next state budget, would you want hospitals to get a higher priority than maybe they got in the current budget?
Absolutely. Look, this is where we've got to be thinking about our healthcare system more broadly and more collaboratively. You know, we have money that has been left on the table because we haven't taken the Medicaid expansion money, right? And so ultimately, something like that is a way that you also invest in the healthcare and the hospital system. That will pay off in the end because we'll have the resources not only for the prevention at the front end for people getting sick, but also once they actually need the services. So absolutely, you know, my background is in community health education and public health. So I always think about this through a prevention first, an investment first, because the models tell us that when we invest money in prevention, it pays off in the end. But absolutely, the hospitals are doing an incredible job stepping up. Our healthcare workers are doing an incredible job stepping up every day. We have to invest in those frontline workers to show them how much that we appreciate them. And we've got to, you know, keep that system going to keep people healthy.
Do we need a state law that says if a business follows all the COVID mm-hmm. safety and health rules, they could not be sued? A frivolous lawsuit could not be filed against them by either a customer who thought they got COVID there or someone who worked there?
You know, when I was looking at this question, I was thinking, and I don't know if you have anything to share, Steve, if there has been an uptick in these lawsuits, and I couldn't really find anything about that.
Well, the background is U.S. Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell said he wouldn't support another COVID-19 package unless there was this type of legal
protection for business owners.
Yes. So that's kind of the background.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think it's a bad idea. I mean, I think anytime you can protect small businesses from unnecessary litigation, it could be a good thing. My question, though, is it necessary? I mean, the legislation and legislators and all of our elected officials have so many competing priorities on the table right now. And so my question for everyone would be, is it a top priority? Is it something that absolutely is needed? Or is it something that takes our eye off the prize to something that we really should be working on? So I'm not against it. It's just a question of prioritization.
Okay. We've got a little time left. Any one issue that is central to your campaign that we haven't touched on yet, Kristina?
No, I mean, I think this has been great, Steve. I think, you know, for me running in this race, it is about representation. That is what makes me different. That is what I'm running on. I love this community. Serving on the Green Bay School Board as the vice president has been one of the most tremendous experiences of my life. My two young kids go to a school right down the street from my house. And, you know, like I said, when we started this, what we are facing right now, climate change denial, rising healthcare costs, water quality, diminished workers' rights. This requires us to have someone, Madison, who has our back and can go to bat for us and with us. And, you know, when I learned about Representative Brzezinski's sexual harassment of an employee, my communications director tells me not to say this, but it's true. I had no plans to run for the assembly. I work locally. I'm a very busy young mother and I have a lot on my plate. When this happened and I learned about our representation, it was a call to action. I didn't have a choice. I had to do this. And within that process, I have learned that this is where I need to be and what I need to be doing. It has been an honor to get to meet the residents and the constituents of the 90th and to be able to represent them. And I'm really excited for August 11th. You know, our campaign is not just about asking for their vote, but really to get people excited again about their representation in Madison. We have a Spotify playlist. We have T-shirts and feminist art. And so we want people to feel like they're a part of something, right? That they're excited to be with us. And I think that's translating in around the community. We've got people picking up shirts all the time, and it's a beautiful thing. And, you know, we've got 4 weeks left, and there's nothing more than what we want than to win on August 11th to get through to the general.
Thank you. Kristina Shelton is of Green Bay, is a Democratic candidate in the 90th Assembly District. As she said, the primary is August 11th. Kristina, thank you for talking to WisconsinEye.
Thanks, Steve. Have a great rest of your day.
You too. Thank you.
Take care.
Campaign 2020 is sponsored by Wisconsin Hospital Association, Quick Trip, Wisconsin Counties Association, Wisconsin Realtors Association, and Wisconsin Operating Engineers Local 139.